What is a wild card? A wild card is a person who takes personal initiative. An idea comes to them, often a creative idea, and they just go out and do it. That's what I call a wild card. And it was when I discovered this that my passion for serving came alive. And I'm hoping that this can do the same for you. I grew up going to church. My sister brought me to church. And if you were to ask me, based on my church experience as a kid, how do you serve Jesus? I probably would have said, here's how you serve Jesus. You volunteer to be an usher, or you volunteer to sing in the choir, and that's it. Or you could be a missionary, maybe, if you're really radical. That was my perception of serving Jesus. It was very limited. It was very two-dimensional. I would draw it like this. Just very sort of black and white and limited. But then something started to change my thinking. And here's what changed my thinking. I started reading the Bible. And this took me a while, but over the years of reading the Bible, I saw examples of people taking personal initiative. I saw examples of people taking creative personal initiative in serving Christ. And it's these people I call wild cards, and that's what this category is based on. Let me show you a few biblical examples of what I'm talking about. This is the first one that I noticed, by the way, from the book of Luke chapter 5. It goes like this. Later, Levi, now just pause there, Levi was a tax collector, which means he was probably older and he was probably wealthy, okay? Later, Levi held a banquet in his home with Jesus as the guest of honor. Many of Levi's fellow tax collectors and other guests also ate with them. Now, do you see what happened here? Levi had encountered Jesus, and his life was changed. But Levi had friends who had not encountered Jesus. Now, do you know how hard it is to bring your friends to come hear a teaching? It's like bringing people to church. I bet Levi couldn't do it. So he thought, what if I feed them? What if I have a banquet? Levi probably had a nice house. He could probably afford a great banquet. If you feed them, they'll come. So he invites his friends, he invites Jesus, and he just lets happen what Jesus wants to happen. And we never see this anywhere else in Scripture. Only Levi does this. It's unique, it's creative, and it's personal initiative. Now, another example I'd like to show you, I need to set up. There's a woman in the book of Acts named Dorcas. Or Tabitha. I guess she had kind of two names. Anyway, Dorcas passed away, and her friends went and got Peter, because at that time, the Lord was doing amazing healing miracles through Peter. So she passed away, and they ran and got Peter to heal her, and he does heal her. But in the description, we find out something about her, and here's what it says. From the book of Acts, chapter 9, the room was filled with widows who were weeping and showing him, that refers to Peter, the coats and other clothes, Dorcas had made for them. In that time and in that culture, if you were a widow, that meant you were destitute. With no source of income and no husband, you lived in poverty. Okay? This obviously weighed on Dorcas's heart. And she thought, what can I do? And so she started making stuff for them. She took personal initiative, and she creatively took her skills to minister to them. I'll give you another example. There's a time when Jesus was eating with some religious elite, the powerful Pharisees of his day, and unexpectedly, a woman arrives. And here's what happens from the book of Mark, chapter 14. While he was eating, a woman came in with a beautiful alabaster jar of expensive perfume made from essence of nard. She broke open the jar and poured the perfume over his head. The text reveals that this perfume was extravagantly expensive, and this was an expensive jar. Obviously, this woman wanted to honor Christ. And so she did so by spending a lot of money and wasting it on him. That was the perspective of the men in the room, by the way. They were offended at the extravagance of her gesture. But Jesus corrected them and said, leave her alone. What she's doing is a good thing. Okay, so here we have examples of creative personal initiative. Now, creative is an important word in this process because this is something else that the Bible teaches us. The Bible teaches us that we are all creative. If you were to ask 100 people, are you creative? I would guess that 80 to 90 of them would say, no, I'm not. Even people who are obviously creative have a hard time simply saying, yep, I'm creative. It's something that we tend to shy away from. And that's wrong, because you are creative. How do I know this? Well, when you open up your Bible, page one of your Bible, Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, what is the first thing we find out about God? Here it is right here. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The first thing we find out about God is he is creative. Okay? God is a creative God. Now, all of us know this, but just to maybe refresh our understanding of this, I want to show you a flower. And this is a photo that Brent's wife, Mary, sent me yesterday. Isn't that an extraordinary thing? You see, what's this show us? This shows us that God doesn't just do what is practical or utilitarian. He creates extravagantly. He creates beauty. He has fun with it. Doesn't it look like maybe God had fun with this? I think God had fun with a lot of creation. Look at giraffes. Or elephants. Or any animal. Look at Pete. Look at yourself. I think God had a blast being creative, okay? So our God is a creative God. That is unmistakable. But then when we turn the page in our Bibles to the next page and look at verse 27 of the first chapter of Genesis, we see this. So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. We are the only thing that are created in God's image. That means you and I resemble God in many different ways. Our God is a creative God. You are created in his image. That means you are creative. Now, right now, many of you are thinking, no, I'm not. I've been around me a long time, and I know that I am not creative. Okay? In a few moments, a little later in the message, I'm going to explain to you why you think you're not creative and how you can become creative again. But before we get there, I want to show you something else. Not only do we see personal initiative, not only do we see creativity in that we are creative, but we see a process for effective ministry, okay? There's a way to go about this. Being a wild card doesn't mean you just run out and do something crazy. There is a process we see in Scripture, and this process is summed up succinctly in a single sentence in the book of Matthew. And here's the sentence from Matthew chapter 14. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them and healed their sick. That's your roadmap to ministry right there. Let's take it in three pieces. The first part is this. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat. Step one, see the need. Seeing the need is the first step to creative service. Okay, you can't go right to what are you going to do and then figure out how it's going to serve people later. Start with the need. And by the way, there is a tremendous blessing for you in this single step. What do I mean? I'll tell you a secret about yourself. Do you want to be miserable? Then think only of yourself, and you're going to be miserable. We are not designed to do that. When we lift our eyes from our own world and our own problems and our own self and start seeing others and what's going on in their lives and start focusing on others, we find purpose, we find a new sense of joy, and we feel more healthy. More healthy. Okay? So first step, lift your eyes and see the need. Second step, and he had compassion on them. Second step is engage your heart. Okay? You can't just see the need and then go right to the solution without engaging your heart. Why is engaging your heart a big deal? I'll tell you why. In 1 Corinthians 13, this is a famous passage that is often read at weddings that says love is kind, love is patient, those types of things. Right in that chapter, in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, Paul tells us that no matter how spectacular our service is, no matter how sacrificial our service is, if it's not motivated by love, it is not only worthless, but it is offensive, like a clanging gong. Okay? The motive of love is what gives our service eternal worth in the eyes of God. Love has to be our motive for our service to have worth and eternal value. Okay? So we need to not only see the need, but we need to engage our heart. Now, let's pause right here. Some of you right now are thinking, I know exactly what is on my heart. I know exactly what need that God is calling me to minister to. Others of you, maybe most of you, are thinking, I know there's a lot of need out there, but nothing is engaging my heart. I don't feel a thing. What do you do? If that is you, I am going to encourage you to pray a dangerous prayer. And here's the dangerous prayer right here. Lord, please put into my heart a holy passion. You pray that prayer sincerely. You lift that up consistently. And I have a feeling God's going to answer it. And it may completely change your life. That's why I call it a dangerous prayer. Lord, put a holy passion on my heart. Okay, let's go back to the verse now. Step one, Jesus saw. Step two, he engaged his heart. And then step three, and healed their sick. That's when Jesus does. Now, a lot of times, what we are to do is obvious. Someone falls off their bike. Okay, you see the need, they're on the ground. It engages your heart. Oh, poor guy. And it's obvious what to do. You go over there and you help them up. Other times we see a need and it engages our heart, but the need seems so big and so overwhelming that we feel like, what can I do? I can't do anything. And so the temptation is just to ignore what's on your heart and do nothing. Don't do that. Instead, this is where creativity enters the room. You need to become the creative person that God designed you to be. And creativity begins with a question. And here's the question right here. How can I use my abilities and resources to serve the need that beats on my heart? How can I take what I have, as limited as it is, and take that and serve the need that I see? Now, here's where I want to talk to people who feel like they're not creative. Because I know you guys may feel like that. You may feel like, I'm sorry, I'm not creative and I can't get creative with this stuff. I just don't think that way. Think back to when you were 4 years old. Imagine that you're 4 years old. And imagine I hand to you a blank sheet of paper and a set of paints. What do? You paint. Little kids love to paint. Something happens on the way to adulthood where, as an adult, I would hand many of you a piece of paper and a set of paints, and you would say, I'm not talented, I can't paint. Something happens along the way. Now, in the creative process, it is necessary to have two roles. And you got to understand this. There's the artist role and the editor role. The artist creates and creates, and the editor critiques. Okay, two roles. When you're a little kid, you are 100% artist and 0% critic. You just create and you don't judge. By the time you become an adult, what happens a lot is you are 100% editor and 0% artist. What happens is you edit before you create, so no creation happens. I give you paint, I give you paper, I say, why don't you paint something? And you're like, I can't paint. See, you critiqued yourself before you even did anything. Okay? Here is the secret to creation, to being creative. You got to kick the editor out of the room. You got to say, hey, it's not that I don't like you, Mr. Editor, but you really need to leave now because the artist is going to go to work. Sometimes I have people, I like to write songs. I've talked to a lot of songwriters over the years, and they say, I can't write anything decent. I don't know what to do. I've got writer's block. I can't do anything. I always say the same thing. I say, can you write a bad song? They go, yeah. Can you write the world's worst song? Probably. Okay, write 50 of the world's worst songs. Okay, without judgment, just write them. Just do it. And then when you got all those songs, spend about a year doing it, man. This is work. Then bring the editor in and say, look at these terrible songs. And the editor will look at all those things and say, you know what? Song number 7 is really good. In fact, if you just change like one or two little things, that'd be really good. And then you got something. That is the secret to being creative, is separating the artist from the editor. Now, how does this apply to serving people in need? You need to brainstorm based on your abilities, based on your resources, based on what you have. Brainstorm different options without judgment. And then later, after you have a bunch of stuff, then critique and figure out what you want to do. This is obviously what Levi did. Levi's like, I want my friends to meet Jesus. I don't know what to do. So he got creative and said, I have a house. I can afford a banquet. I can feed these guys. I'll invite them over and invite Jesus. This is what Dorcas did. These women are in need, but I can make clothing, so I'm going to make clothing. Or another example, right here in our own church, would be Jamie Krieg. This is a photo of Jamie. And I'm going to read a little bit of her story. There's a time when the young adults pack food for Kids Against Hunger almost every week. Okay, and she writes about this, and you can get the whole story on my blog, which is, if you're interested, it's in my bulletin. It's in that bulletin. But as I read her story, as I read what she wrote, keep in mind the process that we just outlined. Seeing the need, it weighs on your heart, and then creatively coming up with a solution based on the abilities and resources that you have. Okay, here's what Jamie writes. There was a season of time when the young adults ministry met every other week to pack food. And it was an amazing time of unity and outreach as people brought their friends to join. Although I was saddened when this had to cut back and eventually end this consistent packing schedule because there wasn't enough funding to buy raw materials at the rate that we were going through them, I felt strongly that there had to be something we could do. But as I was in my early 20s, I didn't think any idea I came up with would amount to much. What's that? That's the editor right there saying, you can't do it. But she kicked the editor out of the room. The Lord really impressed upon my heart that although I didn't have the income to give in a substantial way, He had given me a talent. I was a trained hairstylist, and I met with Pastor Tim Weber and expressed my desire to start a fundraiser for KAH by getting a couple of my stylist friends together to cut hair, and we would ask for a specific donation amount for the organization. To my surprise, but not to God's surprise, Tim and the other pastors were supportive and encouraged me to move forward. We like wild cards. I had no idea the amount of work that went into planning an event like that, but that is where this incredible church body came in. I had friends step in to help, and with each person working with their God-given gifts, we were able to host 6 Haircuts for Hades events over the course of 3 years. That's what I'm talking about. She also organized the Kids Against Hunger concerts. And again, if you want to read her whole story, it's right on my blog. Another example would be someone from our church, Dan Dibbing, who led worship just last week, so you may recognize him. Dan is also a music producer, a music writer, and a rapper. And his rapper name is Dijon. Him and a fellow rapper friend of his named True Serva had on their hearts the issue of human trafficking. Okay, now isn't that an issue that seems too big to really do anything about? That'd be an easy one to let the editor tell you, you can't do anything, and you give up and you ignore what's on your heart. But Dan didn't do that. Him and his friend True Serva created a song and a video to raise awareness and to teach and to educate on the issue of human trafficking. And I looked this morning, and this video is on YouTube, and it's had over 16,000 views. I would say God is probably using what they did. See how this works? You see a need, it weighs on your heart, and you use your God-given creativity to come up with some way to serve that need. You know, I think one of my first sort of attempts to do something that I'm describing to you happened a few years ago. My daughter and a group of her friends all wanted to learn guitar. And what was on my heart was not just that, but probably more so, is I just wanted them to start learning scripture. And one of the best ways for kids to learn scripture is through Bible scripture songs. So we had a guitar class, and that's a photo of it. And we charged like a kind of a one flat rate, and for that rate you got like the music and the guitar, okay, and the tuner and everything you need. I wrote about 12 scripture songs, starting from super easy to play all the way up to a little bit harder to play, and we learned those songs. And what I learned was a couple things. One is it was very different than just sort of signing up for something and showing up and then going home. This was something that engaged my heart. I had to work at it. I had to plan it. I had to get it all organized. And I had to worry about it. I had to worry about, like, will anyone show up? Will they like this? It engaged me more fully than other things that I've done. And was it successful? Well, you know, our job is faithfulness, not results. Results are God's job. But a bunch of those kids are still playing guitar now, and hopefully the Lord used it in different ways. Here's how it works. Imagine a Venn diagram, and you have a circle, and it starts with noticing the need. This is just a way for me to understand this, and hopefully this will make it even more clear to you. You see the need. You get your eyes off your world, and you notice that what someone else needs, okay? Just like Jesus did. And needs are multiple and varied. You know, sometimes it's for physical things like clothing or food or shelter, but everyone needs the gospel. So that's why we're emphasizing the gospel this year through our Taking New Steps of Faith. If someone doesn't have the gospel, then that is definitely a need. But you start with the need, and then you let your heart become engaged, okay? Because your motive has to be love for it to have eternal worth. Ask God, Lord, put into my heart a holy passion. Lord, my heart's available. Put it in there. Okay? And then you get creative. You take your resources and your abilities and whatever you have, and you think, how can I use this stuff to minister to that need? No matter how limited you feel, you can do something. And where those three circles intersect is that red area, and that's where the wild card lives. And let me tell you something. To live there will cost you more than you think. It will. It'll take more time and energy and emotion. It'll take more than you expect. And that's good. Because there is a huge blessing there. Here's what Jesus said. Matthew chapter 10, verse 39. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for me, you will find it. The secret to finding true life is to give your life away to build the kingdom of God. So please take this to heart. Take this to heart. And ask for a holy passion if you don't have one. And if you do have one, then it's time to get creative.